ओके, शैल वी स्टार्ट द क्लास? द प्रीवियस क्लास वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट डिवाइसेस. ऑल ऑफ यू प्लीज म्यूट योर डिवाइसेस. इन द प्रीवियस क्लास वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट सम ऑफ द स्केड्यूलिंग एल्गोरिथम्स लाइक FCFS एंड SJF. लेट मी रिमाइंड फ्रॉम द बेसिक स्केड्यूलिंग कॉन्सेप्ट. व्हाई? बिकॉज़ अ फ्यू ऑफ आर नॉट अटेंडिंग द सेशन. They are still joining. Only 54 participants are available. So let me rewind the topic again. So what for scheduling? So actually, before going to discuss about scheduling, you need to have a strong foundation on job queue and the ready queue, right? Initially, all the processes are available in the job queue. So from those job queue, subset of programs are selected by the long-term scheduler, and those programs will be kept in the main memory ready queue. Okay, whenever the subset of programs available in the main memory, that means those programs are waiting in the ready queue for the CPU, right? The responsibility of a short term scheduler, observe here, it is the responsibility of a short term scheduler to select one process from those three processes. In our example, we have a three process in the main memory ready queue. So it is a responsibility of a short term scheduler to select one process among the three and allocate CPU to that particular process. Okay, that is called as scheduling, right? In order to select one among the three, what I told you, there are three programs in the main memory in the ready queue. So the job of short term scheduler is to select one program or one process among those three process. So how the short term scheduler will select one among the three, where the scheduling algorithms came into picture. Okay, in those three, CPU has to allocate only one process. The operating system can allocate CPU to only one process, but we have three processes in the ready queue. How come it possible? There is only one CPU and there are three processes. CPU can run only one process at a time. So it is the responsibility of operating the system to select, to allocate the CPU to one process. So what it will do? So at that time, the short term scheduler will use the scheduling algorithms. So based upon the scheduling algorithm, what we are, so one process will pick from the three. Okay, so there are two categories of scheduling algorithms. One is preemptive algorithm and the second one is non-preemptive algorithm. So what is preemptive scheduling algorithm and what is non-preemptive scheduling algorithm? The first one is non-preemptive algorithm. Non-preemptive means once you allocate CPU to a process, the process never releases the CPU until it completes the execution or it went to the waiting state. Okay, what about the preemptive scheduling? Once you allocate the CPU to the process, the CPU may be preempted to some other process. That means the CPU may be switched to the some other process if that process is a high priority process. For example, P1 is a low priority process. Now we are allocating CPU to P1 and CPU executing the P1. While executing P1, maybe a high priority process called P2 came into the ready queue. Okay, at that time the CPU will be preempted from P1 and it will be assigned to P2, switched to P2 from low priority process to high priority process. Till we are not completing the execution of P1, but automatically whenever the high priority process came into the ready queue, automatically CPU will switch from P1 to P2. That is called as preemption. Okay, and next dispatcher. So what is a dispatcher? Dispatcher is a module. What the functionality of a dispatcher? It gives a complete control of CPU to a process. Okay, so that process will be selected by the short term scheduler or CPU scheduler, as you know, and that particular process need to be executed by the CPU. So the responsibility of a dispatcher is to give a CPU control to the process and switching, context switching and switching to the user mode from the kernel mode. Okay, so after moving from kernel mode to user mode, you need to resume the process where you stop earlier. You need to start from that particular point of only. So that is called as jumping to the proper location in the user program to restart that program. Okay, that is the third point. So all these are the responsibility of a dispatcher. Okay, and these are the points under scheduling criteria. CPU utilization means we need to keep the CPU always busy, and next the CPU utilization need to be more, and next throughput. What is throughput? If the CPU utilization is more, so automatically CPU can execute more number of programs. If the CPU execute more number of program per unit time, automatically the system performance will be more. Okay, throughput is the number of processes executing per unit time. It need to be more. And the next one is a turnaround time. What is turnaround time? Turnaround time is a time spent from submission of a process to completion of the process. The total time, it may be waiting in the ready queue sometime, and it will be executed by the CPU sometime, and when it may went to the waiting state again, and from waiting state again it may waiting coming to ready state, and from ready state to running state, like that in a process life cycle, it move from one state to another state, waiting in so many number of queues, right? So all these are calculated, accumulated. So then we will get the turnaround time. So the turnaround time means the total time from the submission of a process to completion of a process. Okay, and the next one is a waiting time. What is waiting time? Waiting time means a process waiting in the ready queue for the CPU. So that the time spent by a process on ready queue is called as, in ready queue is called as waiting time. And the next one, response time. What is the response time? So after submission of a process, you will get the first response to the user. Okay, user will get the first response from the process. The time it takes to get a first response from the process is called as response time. The response time and the waiting time and the turnaround time need to be low. Throughput as well as CPU utilization need to be more. Okay. And from this point onwards, we need to discuss about scheduling algorithms. So as there are problems, we no need to go for the slides. Okay. We already discussed about FCFS. What is FCFS? First come, first serve. Okay. What is first come, first serve? Which process came into the ready queue first, that process will get the CPU. Which process came into ready queue first, will came into ready queue first will be executed by CPU first. Okay, so that is called as FCFS, first come first serve. Okay, and the next one, what you need to understand, there will be a problem. Process and then burst time. So whenever you want to write in the final examination, you need to give the description about first come first serve, and then you need to solve the problem. So problem will be automatically available in your question paper. So from that you need to get the data, and you need to solve the problem. So P1, P2, P3 are the three process. Maybe P1 requires 10 milliseconds of CPU time to complete its execution, and P2 requires 5 milliseconds, and P3 requires 4 milliseconds. So this is the bus time calculation. So sorry, these are the bus times to complete the execution, right? from these, what you need to do? You need to prepare a Gantt chart. Right? What I told you, as it is a FCFS algorithm, so whoever coming first will get the CPU first. Whoever coming first in the ready queue will get the CPU first. So the processor coming into the ready queue in this manner. And the first is P1 came and P2 came, after that P3 came. Okay? This is the Gantt chart. So initially P1 is not waiting for anything. So the P1 will get the CPU first. Why? Because it came into the ready queue first. It completes its execution. Why? Because P1 requires 10 milliseconds of time to complete its execution. So 0 to 10. After that, P2. How much then P2 requires? 5 milliseconds. So 10 plus 5 means 15. Okay. After that, P3 came into ready queue. So P3 requires 4 milliseconds. So whenever you want to draw the Gantt chart, you need to take care of these portions. You need to take care of these portions. Okay. Observe this diagram. How I draw the diagram? So P1 requires 10 milliseconds and P2 requires 5 milliseconds. So this particular portion is bigger than this particular portion. It is only 5 milliseconds. So it might be the half portion of this one. So that is the reason why I have given this particular portion to P2. And then P2 requires 5 milliseconds and whereas P3 requires only 4 milliseconds. So that is the reason why. So 4 milliseconds is lesser than 5 milliseconds. So the portion will be little bit less, right? So while drawing the Gantt charts, you need to observe. You should not draw like that. So for P1, this one is a wrong one. P1 10 and P2 5. Like that you should not draw. This is the wrong notation. Why? Because this is bigger than this one, this portion. This represents 10 milliseconds, whereas this represents only 5 milliseconds. So 5 milliseconds portion is bigger than the 10 millisecond portion. So you should not draw like this, okay? This is the correct one, okay? Okay, after preparing the Gantt chart, so what you have to do, you need to calculate the average waiting time. What is average waiting time? What is average waiting time? So in order to get the average waiting time, you need to know the waiting time of individual process. Waiting time of P1. So what is the waiting time of P1? P1 is not waiting for any process to complete. So waiting time of P1 is 0. What is the waiting time of P2? The waiting time of P2 is 10. Okay. The waiting time of P2 is 10. What is the waiting time of P3? The waiting time of P3 is 15. Why? Because P3 is waiting for the CPU until P1 and P2 completes its execution, right? So the waiting time of P3 is 15. Okay. So what is the average waiting time? P1 waiting time plus P2 waiting time plus P3 waiting time divided by 3. So it is 25 by 3. That means it is 8.33 milliseconds. That is the average waiting time. Is it clear for you all?
Yes, ma'am.
Right? Here you need to understand one more point. So as I told you, there are two types of process. One is I/O bound and the second one is the CPU bound. So what is I/O bound? I/O bound process. I/O bound. I/O bound process and the second variety of process is CPU bound process. What is I/O bound? I/O bound means process require more IO operation than CPU computations, right? And it doesn't require much CPU time. Why? Because the computations are low when compared to IO operations. So such type of process are called IO bound process. What is CPU bound? CPU bound process requires more, and these process spent more time on computation and less time on IO operations. So such type of process called as CPU bound means it requires more CPU time. It requires more CPU time for the computation and less time for the IO operations. But whereas in the case of IO bound means it requires more IO operations than the CPU computation. That means IO bound process requires less CPU time, whereas CPU bound process requires more CPU time. Okay, so what is the need of discussing all these points here in the FCFSEs? So if the more number of process in the ready queue are IO bound, in the ready queue many are IO bound. I will erase this one and then. For example, we have many IO bound processes. We have many IO bound process and only one CPU bound process in the ready queue. Okay, so CPU bound means, as I told you, what happened? It requires that one process requires more CPU time. All the remaining are IO bound. So all these process requires remaining. All the remaining process require. All the remaining processes require IO devices. Okay, so what we will do? So we allocate CPU to, maybe there are 5 processes. P1 is a CPU bound, for example. P2, P3, P4, and P5. These 5 are maybe IO bound. Okay, these 4 requires IO devices. So they are busy with doing IO operations, and P1 is busy with the CPU. That means CPU executing the P1. Okay, so all these are the IO bound, right? So they require little CPU time, less CPU time, little CPU time. Okay, so automatically CPU is now executing the P1, and P1 is a CPU bound, so it requires more CPU time. So while CPU is executing the P1, that these process might complete their IO operations. They are waiting for the CPU in the ready queue. But P2, P3, P4, P5, all these require less CPU time, right? And P1 requires more CPU time. So automatically what happened? So all these P2, P3, P4, P5 requires less CPU time, but these all process are waiting for one process to complete its execution. P2, P3, P4, P5, all these 4 process are waiting for one process to complete its execution. Why they are waiting? Why? Because EP is now allocated to P1 and FCFS is, what is FCFS? FCFS algorithm is a non-preemptive algorithm. FCFS algorithm is non-preemptive algorithm. So what is non-preemptive? Once we allocate the CPU to process, once we allocate a CPU to the process will never release the CPU, never release the CPU until it completes its execution. So automatically CPU, in our example, CPU is allocated to P1. So P1 will never release the CPU until it completes its execution. As it is a CPU bound, CPU bound process, so automatically it requires much CPU time to complete its task. So P2, P3, P4, P5 are the IO bound process. They require only less CPU time to complete the execution. So all these four processes are waiting for the one big process to complete its task. So that is called as convey effect. So very important concept for your gate exam or any competitive exams. Even the interviewer might ask you the question. So FCFS means first come first serve. Anyone can solve the problem and anyone can give the details about the first come first serve. But so in a first come first serve, there is a problem called as convey effect. Okay, what is convey effect? All the programs, all the small processes, all the process requires a little CPU time, waiting in the ready queue much time for the CPU bound process, one big process, to complete the execution. That is called as convey effect. So why it is happened in the FCFS? Why the convey effect happened? Why because FCFS is a non-preemptive algorithm. So because of the non-preemption, so even though P2, P3, P4, P5 are waiting for more time in order to get the little CPU time, but still one big process P1 is using the CPU. It never releases the CPU to the remaining process until it completes the execution. For example, P1 requires 10 milliseconds of CPU time, whereas P2, P3, P4, P5 may require only 1 millisecond or 2 milliseconds of time to complete execution. So these 1 millisecond, 2 millisecond CPU time is very less when compared to the 10 milliseconds. But all these small CPU required process, CPU time required process, are waiting for the one big process to complete its execution. So that problem is called as convey effect. Okay, why convey effect is a problem in FCFS? FCFS is a non-preemptive algorithm. Because of that reasons, once we allocate a CPU to one process, it never releases the CPU to other processes until it completes its execution. That is called as non-preemption. So because of the non-preemption, FCFS has a convey effect. There is a convey effect problem. Okay. Convey effect means all the small processes which require the CPU time less are waiting in the CPU much time for the big process to complete its execution. Okay. And the next one is a shortest job first. So shortest job first. What is shortest job first? Shortest job first means which process require less burst time, which process requires less burst time, will get the CPU first. Okay, P1 might be any value you can give, 3 and then 2. So if you do like this, automatically one by one you'll get the, okay, not an issue. So if you observe this one, So which process have a lowest CPU burst time? P3, right? P3 requires only 2 milliseconds of time. So P3 will get the CPU first. So automatically from 0 to 2 milliseconds, from 0 to 2 milliseconds, CPU will be allocated to P3. After that, 3 is a small number. So automatically will give CPU to P2. So 2 milliseconds, the portion is little bit more. Okay? 2 plus 3 means 5. Right? 5 milliseconds to complete the task. And next, what about P1? P1 is the last process. Why? Because it requires 4 milliseconds of time. So 9. So this is about the Gantt chart. I repeat, what is shortest job first? Which process has the lowest burst time requirement will get the CPU first? Right? So in this particular one, 4, 3, 2. So 2 is a small number. So automatically we have given the priority to P3. And then 3 is the next smallest. So automatically P2 will be executed next. And the last one is a P1. So now we need to calculate the waiting time. Waiting time of P1, waiting time of P2, waiting time of P3. Okay. So what is the waiting time of P1? The waiting time of P1 is 5. What is the waiting time of P2? 2. What is the waiting time of P3? 0. Okay. Now you need to calculate average waiting time. So 5 plus 2 plus 0 by 3. So automatically 7 by 3. 2.33 milliseconds, right? So that is about shortest job first. Okay, this is also non-preemptive. This is also non-preemptive. Why? Because once
all doubt, ma'am.
Yeah, tell me.
What is the necessity of calculating the waiting time or average waiting time?
So average waiting time means, as I told you, in the scheduling criteria, we have waiting time is there. CPU utilization, throughput, turnaround time, and the waiting time. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So waiting time means all the processes are waiting in the ready queue for the CPU. For example, if there are 3 processes, so in those 3 processes, we need to allocate only 1 process to the CPU. Okay? So whenever we complete more number of programs with less time, automatically the system throughput will be more. That means the waiting time need to be less. Okay?
Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
So individual waiting time not give us a better idea about the number of programs executed per second. All the process waiting time need to be less. Then only we can assign. That means if the waiting time is less for all the process, what it indicates, all the processes are allocated to the CPU immediately when they are entered into the ready queue, so that CPU can execute the process in a faster manner, so that the throughput of a system will be more. Are you got my point?
Yes, ma'am.
Very good question, ma. Right? And the next one, preemptive scheduling. Preemptive SJF. Okay, what? That means the SJF, shortest job first, is both the preemptive scheduling and the non-preemptive scheduling. Right? One more problem under SJF, shortest job first. Process, bus time, and you need to have one more column that is called as arrival time. Arrival time. Okay. For example, there are three process P1, P2, P3, and the burst time of P1 is 3 milliseconds, and the burst time of P2 is 4 milliseconds, and the burst time of P3 is, for example, 5 milliseconds. So the arrival time. No. I'll change this one. If you give this value as 6, so that you have better idea. Okay. So there, these are the arrival times. Okay. Now, actually, what is shortage of first? The process which has a lowest burst time will get the CPU first. Now, which process will have the lowest CPU burst time? Tell me. P1, P2, P3. In those.
P2 process.
What? Which one?
P2.
Actually, we need to assign the CPU to P2 first. But so P2 is entering into the ready queue at first after one millisecond. After 1 millisecond. Okay. So this is the ready queue, for example. In the ready queue, which process enter the ready queue first? At the 0th second, P1 is available in the ready queue. At that time, P2 and P3 are not in the ready queue. By that time, they are not in the main memory. Are you got my point? Arrival time means when the process came into the ready queue. Okay? At the 0th second, P1 is entered into the ready queue. By that time, there are no other process in the main memory. So there is only one process in the main memory ready queue, that is P1 process. Okay, no other process are in the main memory at the 0th second. Only the first process enter into the ready queue is P1. So that there is no ambiguity. There is only one, as there is only one process P1, the P1 will be allocated to the CPU first. So automatically, even though P1 burst time is more, but there are no other process at that time. At that time, only P1 enter into the ready queue. So automatically, we will give chance to the P1. How many seconds? Not the complete 6 seconds. We'll give only 1 second of time. Why? Because after 1 millisecond, what happened? So P2 is came into the ready queue. P2 came into the ready queue after 1 millisecond. Okay. After 2 milliseconds, maybe P3 came into the ready queue. Are you got my point or not? If it is true, then it will be very good example. Right. Now, let me explain you the concept. Okay, at the 0th second, no process is there in the main memory. So we have given a chance to P1 to execute. After 1 millisecond, what happened? P2 came into the main memory for the execution. What is the burst time of P2? The burst time of P2 is 4. So up to this point, we have given a chance to P1 for executing 1 millisecond. So automatically the remaining time is 5 millisecond. So what about P2? P2 has a requirement of 4 milliseconds. So 4 is less than 5. So automatically we will preempt the CPU from P1 to P2. Actually, P1 requires 6 milliseconds time to complete the execution. But after 1 millisecond, we have preempted CPU from P1 to P2. Why? Because at after 1 millisecond, P2 came into the ready queue and P2 requires only 4 milliseconds. By that time, P1 requires still 5 milliseconds of time. So when compared to 4 with 5, automatically 4 is less than 5. So automatically CPU preempted to P2. Again P2 will be executed for only 1 second. Why? Because after 2 milliseconds, P3 came into the ready queue. How much time it requires? It requires 2 milliseconds of time to complete. So what about the P2? P2, we have given only one millisecond. So 4 minus 1 means still it requires 3 milliseconds to complete. And whereas P3 came into the ready queue after 2 milliseconds. The arrival time is 2 milliseconds. After 2 milliseconds, P3 is also enter into the ready queue, right? So automatically when compared 2 with 3, 2 is less than 3. So what we have to do? We need to give a chance to P3. How much time we need to give? By all the process are over now. So automatically this is the last process. So how much time it requires? 2 milliseconds. 2 is less than 3 and 2 is less than 5. So automatically P3 will get the CPU first to complete the entire execution. So 2 milliseconds from 2 to 4. So after that, which one is smaller? After completing P3, which one is smaller?
Second process.
Yes, P2 requires only 3 milliseconds. So we are giving chance to P2. Right? So little bit more bigger portion than this one. So 2 to 3. Remaining time is 3 milliseconds. So 3 means 7. After that, the remaining process is only P1. Leftover the process is P1. So how much time it still requires? It still requires 5 milliseconds of time. So 12. P1. Okay. Now you need to calculate the waiting time of processes. Waiting time of P1 and waiting time of P2 and waiting time of P3. Now tell me the waiting times. It is your responsibility to give the answer. What is the waiting time of P1? What is the waiting time of P1?
7 milliseconds, ma'am.
No, it is a wrong answer. I will give you the clue. I will solve for one process for you, and the remaining two you have to tell, okay? So the waiting time of P1 is 7. But in those 7 milliseconds, 1 millisecond will be utilized for the P1 only, right? It is not the waiting time. So we need to subtract 1 from 7. So 7 minus 1. So 6 is the waiting time. This time, see, P1 is not waiting for any process. P1 is executing at the time, initial time. So automatically we need to subtract 1 millisecond from 7. So the waiting time of P1 is 6. Now tell me, what is the waiting time of P2? What is the waiting time of P2?
3.
What is the waiting time of P2?
3, ma'am.
3. How can you say that? So this is a 4 and this one is a 1. 3, how come?
Ma'am, waiting time of P2 is 4, ma'am.
The waiting time of P2 is 4. No, it is also a wrong answer. Why? Because, so this is 4 now. Again, from 1 to 2, the time utilized by P2 itself. So we need to minus that one. It's execution time. P2 execution time, we need to deduct from these 4. Okay.
Ma'am, from 5 we have to reduce 1, no, ma'am.
What 5 means? Where is the 5?
Ikkada first P2 ki 1 second wait chestundi kada ma'am, P1 execution varuku.
1 second wait cheyaledu asalu, P1 appudu system lo raledu kada, P1 vachindi 1 millisecond appudu kada, adi raanappudu wait cheyadu kada ready queue lo.
Okay, ma'am.
Got my point?
Yes, ma'am.
Little bit complexity is there, you need to understand. So me doubt, what is your doubt? So here P1, P2 is waiting for the P1, and then here 4, 4 plus 1, 5 you told, but it is wrong. Why? Because so this is the last one you need to consider, where the P2 is the last appear in the Gantt chart. Here you need to take this value first. Okay, after that what you need to do, from this portion to the first point, is there any P2 appear? Yes, here the P2 appear. How much time the P2 utilizes the CPU time, that we need to deduct from the 4. Okay, 1 to 2, that means 1 millisecond was utilized for the P2 itself. So automatically we need to detect, and we need to check at what time the P2 came into the ready queue. At what time the P1 coming at the ready queue? 1 millisecond. So up to 1 millisecond, P2 is not there in the ready queue. So we need to consider this portion. Okay, we need to consider this portion. So automatically what will be the value?
3.
2. Got my point? Up to this portion, P1 is not available in the machine. And next, after that, that particular 1 millisecond is utilized by the P2 itself. Okay, after that P3 is utilizing 2 milliseconds of time. This time only P2 is waiting for the CPU. So the waiting time of P2 is 2. Are you got my point or not? Simple technique. Whenever it appears last, we need to consider the value. That value minus arrival time minus its execution time. That's it, simple. Okay? 4, and when it was arrived? At 1 millisecond. So we no need to consider that before 1 millisecond. And next, its execution time. How much time it will be executed by the CPU? 1. So remaining is 2. Now tell me about P3. What is the P3? What is about P3?
0, man.
0. Why? Because? So we need to take the value first. This is the value. 2. And then what I told you? Arrival time and its execution time earlier. So arrival time is at what time it arrives in the system? At 2 milliseconds it was arrived. And next, its execution time. So before that, P3 is not available in this portion, right? So 0. So automatically 0 is the waiting time. So what is the average waiting time? 6 plus 2 plus 0 by 3. So it is 8 by 3, and then it means 2.33 milliseconds. Okay. Shall we do one more program on preemptive SJF?
Yes, ma'am.
So that you have confidence. Okay. So preemptive SJF. So in the case of preemptive SJF, we have 3 columns. One is process, and the second one is the CPU burst time, and the third one is the arrival time. So now I would like to take 4 processes, and next burst times 4, maybe 2, and then 5, and then again 2. Right? So the arrival times 0, 1, 2, 3. So now we need to draw the Gantt chart. Okay. Now tell me. So to which process I need to give the CPU first? which process I need to give P1. Give first? P1. Okay. How much time I need to give?
1 second, ma'am.
Okay, 0 to 1. Why? Because after 1 second, after 1 millisecond, P2 came into the picture. So what is the burst time of P2?
2 milliseconds.
2 milliseconds. Up to 1 millisecond, we have given chance to P1. So 4 minus 1 means 3 milliseconds left. So when we compare 2 to 3, which is shorter? 2. So to whom I need to give the CPU?
P2 process.
P2. Okay. So how much time I need to give?
1 second.
Yeah, again, no, not 1 second. So again, after 1 millisecond, who came into the ready queue? P3 came into the ready queue at 2 milliseconds. So by that time, we have given 1 millisecond to P2 already. So leftover is 1 millisecond. So 1 is compared to 5. 1 is comparing with 5. So which one is smaller? Up to this point, P1 has to have 3 milliseconds and P2 is have 1 millisecond and P3 is of 5 milliseconds. So which one is smaller?
1 millisecond.
So I need to give this 1 millisecond to P2 only. Why? Because P2 is smaller than P1 and P3. So I will complete the task. Okay. So next, after 1 millisecond, who came into the picture? P4 also came into the picture. I have given this 1 millisecond, so it is 0. And next, after 3 millisecond, P4 is also came into the picture. So how much time CPU require? How much CPU time required for P4? 2 millisecond. So 2 is comparing with 5 and 2 is comparing with 3. So which one is smaller?
P4. 2 milliseconds is smaller.
So P4. So I will give a chance to P4 to complete this execution. And then what are the remaining? P3 and P1. Whom I need to give? The remaining
P1.
P1, right. How much time? 3 milliseconds. After that, the leftover is P3. P3 requires 5 milliseconds. Now tell me the waiting time of process. Waiting time of process P1, P2, P3, and then P4. Okay, tell me, what is the waiting time of P1? What I told you?
P1. 4, ma'am.
In the Gantt chart, where the P1 appears last? In the Gantt chart, where the P1 appears last? This is the last time the P1
appears. 5 milliseconds.
5. We need to take this 5. And next, arrival time. So what is the arrival time? 0. So you need to keep the arrival time. Minus its execution time. So already before that P1 appears here, how much time P1 consumes? 1 millisecond. So the waiting time is 4. Like that, what about P2? When the P2 appear last in the Gantt chart? Here. Right? 1. And before that, there is no P2. This is the first time P2 appear in the Gantt chart. And next, arrival time. What is the arrival time of P2? 1. And P2 is not appeared earlier. So its execution time is 0. So 0. And then what about P3?
6, ma'am.
And next, when the P3 came into the ready queue? After 2 milliseconds. And next, it is not appeared in the Gantt chart earlier. Before this portion, it is not appeared. So automatically 0. So 6. What about P4? This is the last time P4 appears and this is the first time too. So 3. And next, when it came into the picture? when into P4 came into the ready queue, after 3 milliseconds P4 came into the ready queue. And next, what about the earlier execution? P4 is not appear earlier, so automatically zero. So zero. So what is the average waiting time? P1 waiting time plus P2 waiting time plus P3 waiting time plus P4 waiting time by total number of process, 4. Okay, so finally 4 plus 0 plus 6 plus 0 by 4. So 10 by 4. That means 2.5 milliseconds. Are you got my point? So why why SJF is both preemptive and non preemptive? What is non preemptive SJF? Why is preemptive? What is a preemptive SJF? So here arrival time is there. Whenever you consider the arrival time, automatically actually P1 requires 4 milliseconds of time to complete its execution. So whenever P2 came into the ready queue, automatically without completing the P1 task, we are switching the P1 to switching the CPU from P1 to P2. That means we are preempting the P1 CPU from P1 to P2. And next, whenever P4 came into the picture, so automatically from P2 we are switching the CPU to P4. So P4 requires 2 milliseconds of time, that's okay. So after completing the P4, we switch the P1, and after completing the P1, we switch the CPU from P1 to P3. It is okay. But if we observe here, P1 did not completed its execution. Still we are preempted CPU from P1 to P2. That is called as preemption. Non-preemption means we no need to consider the arrival time. Earlier example. So if you are not considering the arrival time, automatically only two things are available: P1, P2, P3, process, and then bus time 4, 2, 3. So there is no need of preemption, right? First CPU will P2 will get the CPU. Why? Because it is shortest CPU time. After completing the P2 only, we are assigning CPU to P3. After completing the P3 only, we are assigning the CPU to P4. That means we are not preempting the CPU in the middle of the execution. Once we are assigning CPU to P2, CPU will complete the task of P2 and then CPU switched to P3. Once P3 is completed its execution, then only CPU switched to preempted to P1. In the middle of the execution, we are not preempted CPU, right? So that is the reason why if you are considering the arrival time, then SJF will be act as a preemptive scheduling algorithm. If you are not considering the arrival time, the same SJF will be acted as a non-preemptive scheduling. Are you got my point? If you are not considering arrival time, SJF is act as non-preemptive. If you consider the arrival time, the same SJF will be act as a preemptive. Okay, I think you might have another session. I would like to wind up here. So tomorrow, today afternoon we have a session at 1:30. I will take the class in the afternoon session so that I can finish the remaining algorithms. Thank you. And next, don't forget to attend the afternoon session. Okay.